Thanks for watching. In today's video, we'll be talking about dark energy and the ending of Cixin Liu's Death's End. In an uncertain existence, the fact that the universe is expanding is one of the things that we know for sure. When Edwin Hubble was a young man in the early 20th century, the best scientific minds of our time thought that the universe was either static or decelerating due to gravity after the Big Bang. But as Hubble looked out into the stars in the galaxy, he noticed one thing. When comparing the redshift of different stars and different galaxies, he kept noticing that they all appear to be moving away from us. Every single one, every star, and every galaxy that he could observe was moving either away from the solar system or from the galaxy. And even more interestingly, the further away the observed star or galaxy was, the faster it appeared to move away from us. It was directly proportional. As time went on, better optics and better technology and techniques allow for better observation of stars and galaxies further away, and the results were confirmed. The further something away is from us in space, the faster it appears to be accelerating away from us. And this is something that was noticed in every direction of the universe. Why was everything in the universe trying to run away from everything else? Hubble was a young scientist when he made these observations. He had only come back from volunteering from the Great War a few years, and Hubble had just completed his PhD. Is it possible that he had made some mistake in his notes? Is it possible he had made a mistake in his observations? Could all of his measurements be wrong? Little did he know he had made one of cosmology's biggest discoveries in our lifetimes, the discovery of dark energy, or the energy to which we attribute the continuing acceleration of the universe. The universe is expanding in every direction that we can see, no matter what direction we look in, towards the galactic core, away from the galactic core, perpendicular in either direction of the plane of rotation of the galaxy. One thing was constantly true: the further away a star or a galaxy appeared, the faster it appeared to be moving away from us. And we could tell this through what we call redshift. Redshift is a methodology for determining how quickly something is moving away from you, or in the case of blueshift, moving towards you, based on the shift of its emission spectrum. If we know what the light of a star looks like in terms of its spectrum, if we measure it and we have a shift, we can use that shift to determine how quickly that star is moving away or towards us, how quickly that star is moving relative to us. We may have thought the universe was like an ocean, that one day we could send expeditions to other islands to explore. We thought that one day through brilliance and technology, we'd be able to send our astronauts and cosmonauts to the farthest stars, that we would be able to explore the universe and the galaxy just the way that we explored the Earth, that we would discover new worlds among the stars, fly in between solar systems, and reach the distant corners of the universe, that we would build cities among the moons, and unknown new planets. We might have thought that humanity would be a galactic or a universal civilization over time. But how do explorers set sails for islands that are moving away? To islands that are moving away from us faster than our ships can sail? How could our astronauts and cosmonauts reach other solar systems, stars, and galaxies if they're moving faster away from us than our fastest spaceships can go? Is humanity condemned? Is humanity trapped in the solar system? Will we never be able to leave it? At least not with our current understanding of how space-time works? The universe is expanding. According to what we know, the universe should be contracting. But humanity is not blind. We are not completely lost. We still have all the knowledge that we've built up over millennia. Hundreds of men and women around the globe, across time, working tirelessly to understand and describe the physical universe and world around us. The nations of humanity has spent immense energy, time, and capital in trying to unravel the mysteries of the universe. But how could we be so wrong in our understanding of gravity? Whereas the laws of gravity as we understand them now would tell us that due to the gravitational interaction, the universe expansion should be slowing down, eventually stop, reverse direction, and then lead to the big crunch. We know about the conservation of mass. We know about the conservation of energy. In our galactic vicinity, we're able to predict the motion of celestial bodies with our understanding of gravity. So what was so wrong? Why, when you applied our knowledge of gravity on a large enough scale, it breaks down? What is in the universe that we cannot see? What is in the universe that is accelerating the expansion of space-time that we cannot detect, touch, hear, see, or even know that it's there? We only assume that it's there. And since we can't see it or interact with it, we say that it's dark. Since it relates to the motion of the stars moving further away from each other, we call it an energy. Hence, dark energy. But what does this say about our understanding of the universe when we cannot account for 68% of the energy balance of the universe as best as we can calculate it? If the universe started with a big bang and mass and energy is consistent, shouldn't the universe be decelerating? But that's not what we're seeing. Oh no, not in the slightest. Completely contradicting what we expect to find when applying the laws of gravity to the universe. We weren't just a little off, we were completely wrong. Instead of contracting, the universe is expanding. The theory of gravity would describe a universe that is contracting or decelerating, but not accelerating faster and faster. How can we reach the stars if the stars are running away from us? And we don't even know how. How do we catch them? So dark energy, that's what we'll call it. So this dark energy would be this form of energy that's completely around us, but we can no way see or detect, not through our senses or through experimentation or instrumentation. If there's not a big crunch after the Big Bang, what happens when time goes to infinity? What happens to the physical universe? Does it keep expanding until all the galaxies and the stars can't even see each other, that the universe is so vast? In the end, all we have is theories about what constitutes the majority of the universe's energy that we know nothing about. From here, we're switching gears a little bit from science to sci-fi. So, also, major spoiler alerts. Spoiler alerts. Spoiler alerts. Spoilers. Spoilers. We'll be discussing the events that occur at the end of Death's End. Cixin Liu's Remembrance of Earth Past series. Remembrance of Earth's Past is three sci-fi novels, also known as the Three-Body Problem. The Three-Body Problem, The Dark Forest, and then it's finished off with Death's End. Fantastic read. I knocked them out in about 3 weeks. I could not put them down. If I had to describe it in... I would describe them as physics horror. It's a different type of horror and thriller that relies a lot on the mysteries of the laws of the universe and presenting them in a very hostile way. Anyway, awesome series. Highly recommend them. I'll be putting up pictures of them somewhere around here in post-edit. Okay, so moving on to how it relates to dark energy.
I've been reading Tricelaran cosmology, and I came across a proof for the elegance of the mathematics behind the great universe we all came from. The design of the total mass in the universe was precise and perfect. The Tricelarans had proved that the total mass of the universe was just enough to allow the big crunch. If the total mass were reduced even slightly, the universe would turn from being closed to open and expand indefinitely. But mass has been lost, Shangxin said. She understood right away what he was getting at. Yes, the Tricelarans have already constructed several hundred mini universes. How many more have been constructed by other civilizations in the universe to escape the big crunch, or for some other purpose? Each of these mini universes took away some matter from the great universe. Shangxin and Guan Yifan locked gazes. In each other's eyes, they saw the dark future for the great universe. In perpetual expansion, all the galaxies would move further away from each other until none were visible from any other. By then, standing at any point in the universe, all one would see is darkness in every direction. The stars would go out one by one, and all celestial bodies would turn into thin dust clouds. Coldness and darkness would reign over all, and the universe would become a vast, empty tomb. All civilizations and all memories would be buried in that endless tomb for eternity. Death would be eternal. The only way to prevent this future was to return the matter locked up in all the many universes constructed by all the civilizations. But such a decision meant that the many universes would not survive. and all the refugees in the many universes had to return to the great universe. That was the meaning of the name of the Returners movement. The two said everything they needed to say to each other with their eyes and made their decision wordlessly. But Shengxin still spoke aloud. "I want to go back. But if you want to stay here, I'll stay with you."
At the finale of Death's End, after humanity has faded, after the solar system was flattened from three-dimensional to two-dimensional space due to a dimensional strike. A dimensional or a dark forest strike triggered by the gravitational wave signal that was sent out by what would be the galactic humans. The last remaining human survivors, or galactic humans, in about 16 million years after the collapse of the solar system, are existing in a pocket dimension created for them by the Trisolarians. However, it's discovered that moving mass from the universe to the pocket dimension throws off the critical balance of gravity in the universe. And this is where it deviates from the actual science a little bit. By removing mass from the universe, in Death's End's world, it would prevent the universe from collapsing upon itself by removing the gravitational force of that mass. This is where the book deviates from science. In science, we know that the universe is expanding. In the world of Death's End, the universe could possibly contract if there were enough mass in that universe, in that world, or in that existence. And that's artistic liberty. It's still a fantastic read, and it's a minor issue, if anything. But it doesn't change a fantastic ending to a great series. So ultimately, the last survivors of humanity are given an option. They can return all the mass from the pocket dimension back into the universe and allow the natural cyclical nature of the universe to play out, where it would expand and then decelerate and contract again, leading to the big crunch. Or they could break the cycle and prevent life from happening again, thus breaking the cycle. The planets and the stars would never reconstitute themselves because there would not be a big crunch to reset everything. So our protagonists decide to return all the mass from the pocket dimension into the universe because they want to allow life to happen again. They are giving up their eternal life in a universe that's dead and allow the universe to reset itself again, allowing the great cycle of life and civilization across the stars to happen again and again. And we know that's not going to happen in our universe as best as we know at the moment. I think we're done. Thank you very much for watching. What do you think about dark energy? What do you think about the continuous acceleration of the universe? What will happen when time goes to infinity? Let me know what you think. Thank you very much for watching. Take care. Have a good one. Yeah, like, subscribe, and all that, too. I hate asking people to do that. It just seems like... Look, if you know what to do. Every YouTuber says like and subscribe. You've heard it 1,000 times. My saying is just... Oh, something algorithm.